I used to back up PC once, it was quite good. Go back in that Windows box. Okay. It works well if you've got lots of very similar machines, because it's smart about not keeping 8,000 copies of the same library card to make out of the house. That's about something
I sponsor our snapshot into Debian, which is what we're backing up Unix machines sort of over time, because it won't back up the same file again and again and again and use hard links.
Okay.
I have a problem with our snapshot is that on the remote server it needs to run through, because the files are just on the main file system. Without running it through on the remote, you won't have the exact copies of user IDs and other machines these things. So for a full system backup, you would probably need to replicate all the user IDs in the remote server.
Yeah, and you want to use it. Yeah, most of the time when it's used for backing up one person's files. But yeah, to use
right.
Full system backup, yeah, you need some sort of user ID sync, either through a directory service or something like that. Really.
What I've been using lately is the box backup. Provides a backup. Client server system. On the end, the feature is that it tries to be a secure one, so all files stored on the servers are stored encrypted. And it's using OpenSSL for certificate management, so you have to sign the people who are using your backup store. You can assign quotas, soft quotas and hard quotas, to limit what each client is able to backup. And it's tries to use this quota efficiently, so it doesn't, if file got deleted or overwritten, it tries to keep all the copies, but most of them is deleted and they will be garbage collected at the time you need the backup storage.
So what's that one called? Sorry, it's a
box backup.
Box backup.
Yes, it's in Debian Unstable since I uploaded it there.
One of the guys next door asked if there were any of the backup tools reasonably handled. ACL wasn't yet. Because he was having trouble with that. I said I'll ask on his behalf.
I'm not sure how Box Backup is handling with ACL because I don't use it, so you can check that.
But he was reduced to running a script that backed up the ACL stuff to an outer band of the whatever archive he was using.
What it's our department, what we are handling ACLs is storing the ACLs in a plain text file, the directory you want to the ACLs to be applied, and then you can restore them instantly by running setfuckl on that text file, despite the fail in the get back there with ACL. And this works with any backup solution.
Thank you. I think that's something I can use then. Has anybody used the Amazon S3 with the backups at all? So I know there's one commercial company which wraps it in an rsync interface, but I haven't been brave enough to try it yet. Because you get very cheap storage off there. It's sort of alright. The reason I chose it is because it advertised itself as handling D media quite well when I started using it, which it didn't actually, but it does reasonably now. It's a bit big pile of scripts, but it seems to sort of work. It allegedly supports other applications, of course, Windows. Storing stuff, the backups themselves, sometimes been a pain to fiddle with and video, and I had trouble with DVD media as well. Not beyond that, recently. Otherwise, I use RSync.
Administrators. He just written the book. And he said that there was a real shortage of people that could operate big data centers with, you know, hundreds of computers or something like that. He said most of the people were power Linux users, but knowing how to run something, you know, with all that many servers and so forth. And he mentioned one package that all of the big data centers use. And it slips my mind right now, but I think it had something to do with Maryland. University of Maryland.
Amanda.
I think that was the name. That was the name I was trying to come up with.
Yeah. I've used that. It seemed a bit stuck in the 80s with everything's got to go to tape, but you could stick stuff to disk, but it was sort of like, as long as you pretend your piece of disk is really a tape and stuff like that. And it sort of works all right. It was a bit hairy to set up, but I think it's had a lot of testing and it's pretty stable. I haven't used it for a few years.
It's very complicated though as well. I set it up at home.
I think it's overkill.
Yeah, and its logs are weird. It's very much a black box to me, as far as the backup system goes. And it seems to have weak support for scanning tapes. I've done virtual tapes on a hard disk as well. And
it just
seems that the volume you back up has to fit in a tape.
Yeah, and if it doesn't, it really doesn't like it.
Yeah. I've done tapes back, but now I can't restore from that easily. So it's like, well, what's the point?
Yeah. There are commercial tools. I know some of the bigger hosting providers just use these commercial tools. I've never had any experience of them, but it does seem that there's a bit of a gap on enterprise scale stuff. I suppose that's because backups aren't very sexy and people don't like working on them. And certainly people have to back up their own home systems and develop the free tools to do that. But when it comes to enterprise level stuff, it's difficult to get a development environment which stresses it, where it doesn't matter if you fuck up all the backups for all your customers. So I guess that's why there's sort of a gap in free enterprise grade backup tools. Because most of the people who are running that environment, it's too risky to be developing software on it. And setting up a test environment would just be horrifically expensive. I'm not to say it'll never happen, but I think that's those circumstances that, you know, hold it back a bit. That's been my experience. But if anybody has used any stuff that they consider sort of data center grade, if any comments, I'd be just interested to hear about it.
One thing I'd like to ask, seeing as part of the session was meant to be about backup PC, have we actually got anybody in the room that uses backup PC or knows about backup PC?
I installed it on my workstation at home, but I don't use it anymore for something useful.
Why is that?
I don't know. I fell in love with Spock Spector, I mentioned earlier, and it seems to be quite nice for remote administration. You have a PHP front end where you can add hosts and say what to back up where and everything, but...
Have you tried doing a restore with it? I find that half the products, like backing up, becomes nice and easy for them. It's crunch time.
Well, it's quite easy because you can, if I remember correctly, you can even recircle the web interface. So you can say, give clients the possibility to log in on this backup PC, web interface, and say, please get me that file from the backup storage.
Okay. Yeah, that I deployed it about 4 or 5 years ago on a mixed Linux and Windows Office environment, and at that, the web interface was a really cool feature because it kept the users out of the systemic tear. But also, I think if you've got lots of similar systems to back up, it's really cool in the way that it checksums files. You know, if you, you could bang up an office full of PCs and use maybe sort of two PCs worth of storage to do it. I think about 20 PCs, which were a mixture of Debian and Windows boxes, probably took about it squashed it. The sort of squashing you got in the combination of the compression and checksumming it used was probably about 20 or 30 to 1. So it's very storage efficient. But I'm talking about a sort of 4-year-old version of it, so I don't know how it's progressed since. But it coped quite well with machines which were on intermittently as well. You could say, I preferably want to bang this machine up at night, but if it's been off for the last week, then I'll go back up during the day if it looks idle, which was quite a nice feature, which is good for workstations, which a lot of, practically all the other backup stuff I've used is plugged in as servers, so they're assumed to be on 24/7, and they just break if that assumption isn't true.
We have another backup PC who's somewhere along this side, did I say?
Somebody in one of my office mates was playing with it at home. It's on my list of things to play with. One of the things I heard about it that would have made it sound more attractive, apart from the fact that you'd have to do crazy hacking stuff to back up to a hard drive, was it's got single instance store ability, so rather than backing up the same file all the time, you do full backups all the time and the file hasn't changed, just thought that once on this, as like a plant apartment or something like that, apparently. So that sounds like a more efficient way of using your hard drive as a backup store.
I have a question, does anybody is aware of a product which is clever enough to say that all those files from Debian actually match the MD5 file? Of the file, so I don't need to back it down.
Yeah, backup PC does that.
Backup PC does that. And the extended question was, does it have some feature to actually upload some diff files to an FTP server?
Because
actually, I came up with, 3 years ago, I came up with, for my personal use, a very large script today. In which I get all those MD5 files and then make a diff from the previous backup and upload, encrypt all that with GPG key and upload to FTP server. So actually I can turn it every day and upload it to a public FTP server by FIR provides me.
I don't know if backup can still do that.
Any software that would be clever enough to have backup on a public FTP server?
I would imagine that that's something that you could extend backup PC to do if it doesn't do it already. Because it does have this concept of try to only store files once and noticing what the differences are. So it's something that if somebody hasn't already done it, it wouldn't be a huge amount of work, I think. Add it, but I don't know. It's my guess, first guess.
What's this software written in?
I can't remember.
Which one?
I think it's backup PC. Is it Perl?
It looks like it's either written in Perl or extendable
in Perl. I think it is Perl, yeah.
It then looks like it's using everything and then some SMB to connect and talk to the Windows machines and RSync to talk to the Unix machines. And
yeah.
Generally connects to everything from the looks of it. Have we any more questions for each other? Did I'm out?
Yeah, there's some question about not software but configuration. How how often we should do some backup, because I see the Debian machine at not so frequently backup. We had some problem, or we have some problem to check the backup that it worked, that what is okay. This side of control.
I know what I sort of still stick to the, or try to, it doesn't always quite work out in practice. It's probably the other six admins on this as well, but I try and stick to the doing incremental backups fairly often, and then backing up sort of further apart and doing the hierarchy of backups. I'm never quite organised enough for that. So what do other people actually do?
Well, Bacula, if you could set that up to take also Amanda does this, you could say I want a full backup every n days, and I want incrementals between that. And I think some of them do it on two levels as well. So because obviously the more incrementals you're taking, the more single points of failure you've got in the chain. So if you lose one bit of media, then all your latter incrementals, you're missing stuff. So it can take a full backup and then incrementals, and then you can carry on doing incrementals if you want, or if you want, you can then do another big incremental based on the last full backup and start doing smaller incrementals off that, which seems quite a nice way to reduce the dependencies of the incremental chain, if you like. Bacula does that, I think, and I think Amanda does that as well. But I do, Bacula, although I did find it a bit of a pain to set up and get the DVD writing working, while it works, all it does is basically, when the DVD fills up, it sends me an email and says you need to put a new DVD in and write some, and label it. And after two or three days, I didn't really actually get around to doing that. But most of the time, it's a good piece of mind thing. And it manages, it takes care of all the scheduling, and it manages all the labels. And when it decides it needs to reuse stuff, then it'll say, oh, put this old DVD back in our blanket, because according to the rules you've given me, that data's now old enough, you don't care about it anymore. It does take care of all the bookkeeping to do with backups in quite a nice way. But I've done only a handful of restores using it, and it's yet to prove itself in a total disaster. So that's the caveat I'll put around back to that. But I presume other people have. There's something to be said for Amanda for all this craftiness. I would imagine that's the most bulletproof solution in terms of just number of years of testing in the code. But there's a lot of these newer things like backup PC and Bacula they're not as stable, I don't think. That's just the feel I get from them, rather than a sort of empirical measurements, but it's just the feel of the code and the documentation and stuff.
How do you feel about something that uses CPIO?
It's going to be sort of a method of putting stuff on the disk and bringing it back. It doesn't really matter. CPIO is well tested. As long as I don't have to type CPIO commands all the time, I don't think it really matters what it uses as its low level tool. Like all RPM based systems use CPIO all the time, so that's certainly well tested. And it's been around for years and years and years as well.
Well, some of them would use TAR, some of them would use RSync, some of them would use CPIO. What would be the advantages and the use cases for each one of those, really?
Well, RSync's only going to give you a copy of the file. It's not going to give you a container. Whereas a tarball or a CPIO archive give you the equivalent of a zip file, things like that. So a single file that contains a bunch of files and the metadata about those files. So
on the other hand, if you're trying to create a backup on a remote system somewhere, then tar isn't really a good option, because then you need to copy all the files all the time, whereas RSync will only copy changes. So it really depends on your situation. If you say I need to have a mold version of I need to be able to go back to a snapshot of 3 months ago, then RSync isn't going to be a good choice unless you do the snapshot on a remote system, because RSync also removes changes that but it usually removes changes that in some file so that you lose what you had yesterday. So it really depends on what you need for your backup system.
So RSync is kind of out for an enterprise type of...
Well, it depends.
A lot of it depends on how much your systems change, if you're taking remote backups, how slow and expensive your network bandwidth is. It's really, you've got to decide on a case-by-case basis what's the most appropriate tool. I mean, I use Bacula for myself, and I use RSync to take remote backups for some of my customers.
I've also got a customer where I actually need a combination of TAR and RSync. I RSync all systems to a central backup system, which then TARs to tape. Mm. So you can actually build it if you want to.
Where I'm working, we're using different types of backup solutions. We're using TAR, RSync, Zmanda for MySQL database backups, and snapshots for LVMs. So we are using really a bunch of different backup types. It's maybe too much backups, but different backup types, but it works very well. Okay, we're both using local backups and remote backups. Or different things.
How do one look up the launch mail store? It has a data for a load of files, super solid, mail deal. So for me, we do LLM snapshot to make a consistent snapshot of the directory and then just target the server. But is there tools that can reliably do a deep backup on this? Sorry, because there are quite a lot of files. And for example, RSync, it just needs a lot of memory, and it's very long. Somebody has ideas.
No, that is a problem with RSync. But if you're doing very big file sets, that it builds a list of files in RAM. But
yes, it takes four bytes. Remember, for files, or when you have a lot of files, it's not convenient. But as there are some operations.
Well, something like TAR doesn't. It just walks the file system and backs up as it goes. So you don't have any increased memory footprint for something like that. But you don't get a nice sort of auto-incremental stuff that you get with RSync. And that has been a flaw of RSync. I don't see, you can do, it's technically possible to warp the file system while you're doing an RSync. It's just that's not how this all works. That might be an assumption built into the protocol, but I don't think it is. But you could certainly build an RSync type tool that warps the file system and backs up as it goes. It's just that I don't think one exists. The only thing I've had to do when I hit that problem with RSync is just to back up parts of the tree at a time. So you're using this, so each RSync process doesn't run out of RAM.
The point is that we do rather friendly backup ones. So for now, we just make a full copy using TAR one once. And just configure it, assume that the new mail is also push it to separate storage, backup the daily.
If you tried using, GNU TAR's got an incremental format. Yeah. You tried using, has anybody got much experience using that?
I've used that on the system I described earlier with the RSync and TAR. What it does actually is it writes a file with timestamp, just a Unix timestamp.
And any file that has a later date than that is backed up to the next incremental run. And if you want to do a full run again, you just nuke that file as well. And it writes a file at the beginning, so it can happen that you have two incremental runs if your run is very long and files are changing between. So that two incremental runs can actually have the same file backed up. But that's just a minor number of files anyway. The only problem you have with tar is if you want to restore files, you don't have an index at the beginning or anything, so it really needs to search the entire archive. So that they can take a while. I had some other issues with the problem, but anyway.
And what about Zen? Do some abuse with Zen? So perhaps I have a task of making some online backup of Zen instances. Partially I can make LLMs and short of the block device and Zen users, but the problem is memory. Zen has a freeze, so you can house the instance for a little. Then you can save it, but unfortunately the save function and just shut down the instance and need to pick up it later. I wonder maybe someone uses Zen.
What's the name of the package?
It's just XM.
Okay,
standard Zen tool. It can power the instance and then you can use the Zen save and then restore, but then save shut down the instance, so you need to run then restore it later. And the full procedure takes longer. But I didn't found something that can just dump memory, dump it down into the state.
No, the only thing I have done is to take a snapshot of the running Xen instance. And that's the okay.
Yes, but for example, there may be some transactions. The problem is that some of our customers are using my Sun storage. Can be broken when done snapshot because MySQL can finish writing to my Sun storage.
Yeah.
If it was in a DB, it just recovers the first transaction is finished, but no transaction to my Sun storage. I can just get it broken in the DB using just tell.
In that case, you have to go with 13 and do a MySQL database, do a log files and go out there.
Well, but I think it's not the case with my Sun.
I heard of some way of synchronizing MySQL when you did an LVM snapshot, but whether that was a sort of commercial extension or what, I'm not sure. But yeah, I mean the answer is to synchronize your LVM snapshot with your with the database. So the database has to be implicit in getting its files in a consistent state, putting into you're taking the snapshot. So you could do the same thing again with Zen, with all this virtual machine stuff, but I don't know whether there's any on-the-shelf tools to do that.
I better talk to Zen people, so there will be some way to dump them just to memory. Because there are some way, but it's also shut down the instance eventually.
Well, you could do Zen live migration from machine to machine.
Maybe, yes.
That. So if you could do that, then I'm sure you could. You can snapshot
the same way. We are running with a replication, yes, and we want some machines. Replication database with the LVM snapshot. And we have made some tests and we have seen that the data in the database is correct. We are not missing nothing.
You might go lucky.
I wonder why no the way to dump was in memory. Because it would be cool, it just freezes the instance, so it doesn't make any variation. At the time you're making a snapshot of OEM and dump memory, it shouldn't be long. Then you unfreeze the system. So I guess I want TCP connections on just 10, 30 seconds, depending on the memory.
Yeah, well, the, the Zenlive migration does builds up the copy incrementally, so it uses page tables to
some way of copy and write.
It uses the page tables to keep track of which pages are dirty since it did the last thing. So it copies more and more, and then when it's decided it's got 99%, it freezes the running instance. Takes another look at the page tables and sees what's now dirty, syncs that to the new machine, and then kicks it off in the new machine. And I've seen a demo they did. It was something like a third of a second to do the final switch over. So it was a very impressive demo. So if they could do that from machine to machine, then just doing a snapshot of this should be easy.
It would be good to have it also to some disk file or just as a great copy and run, so that it can come and without much downtime. Probably to request it. That would be good rather.
So, I mean, if you can't do that, then I would have thought it's probably not the big job to add that to Zen, because the code to do live migrations already exists.
Yes, they have the system, so they don't separate, so not that the difference.
Anybody else got a question to throw in? I'll throw another one in then, about a different part of it. Quite a bit of discussion, quite a few interesting points about the backup side of things. Another part of this session was supposed to be about the installation. It's not something I've really gone into very recently, and especially not since the Debian installer changes. Is anybody actually using Debian installer to do an automated installation yet? What's working for you, what's not working, who's using Fi, how are people approaching this? Is anybody doing automated installs?
Yes, we're using pre-seeded DI extensively at Google internally for our corporate stuff. We don't use FAI, we use something called Slack, which I'm going to upload to Debian probably this week sometime. It's similar to FAI in that you can have like what we call Slack roles, which are kind of like FAI classes. But it's very simple. It just drops files onto a machine, so we'll have a Slack role, so you are an SMTP server, for example, and that'll drop the relevant configuration files onto that machine, and it has a pre-installed script and a post-installed script, and that will do any extra package installation, that sort of stuff. So we just have the concept of a base image that is what the pre-seeded DI spits out, and then we apply whatever Slack roles we need to get up to whatever it needs to be. And so if the machine dies and needs to be reinstalled from bare metal, we just do an automated install and then start it again.
And is that the sort of thing that a user getting a new computer on their desk would kick off for themselves, or is it a bit more?
We don't use it on the desktop, we use it on the servers more. But you know, someone getting a new server that needed to be a DNS server, for example, could just the build instructions would be install it, slack it with this particular Slack role, you're done. Workstations we also do automated installs on. We use like CF Engine for that, so as well. So the base install will come out that they'll include a bunch of CF Engine stuff.
Is there someone else on the other side using Debian installer or preceding something?
I've been playing with Debian installer. I have had some problems getting the partition scheme right, because I want to make a lot of LVM partitions on different type of file system, SNS3 and SFS.
That sounds like you're further ahead than I am. Maybe somebody, anybody bumped into that before?
A few years ago, I administrated a small internet computer system with some PCs, and there was also the requirement to have fully automated installation because the guy who was running the
the cafe was not able to get any store taken for various reasons. And we provided him with a boot CD, so which just NFS booted with an NFS boot and run fire, and everything was fine. It was installed and had the money machine. I thought that time fire was quite nice to do complicated tasks. The thing is, just our requirements were rather simple, and so we decided to switch to DI because we thought it might be more interesting. Well, for, I don't need to go into details here. But in the end, for simple reason, both are equally usable. If I require some time to, well, perhaps a day or two to understand how it works, things got much improved these days. I tried to create a Fire CD a few days ago on my laptop, and it's really simple. With DI, I always have the problems that, well, I'm trying to install Ubuntu machines and different versions of DIs that have been installing. But my problem is the preceding files is very specific to the release of the Debian installer you're using. And I didn't really figure out some scheme on how to say this precede is related to this version or that version. It causes a lot of confusion to me. I suggested Colin Watson and the Ubuntu set to create perhaps some lint tool on DI precede files that could help you perhaps.
I really like FAI. I used last play for it in a previous job about getting on 5 years ago now, and it was really, I liked it, but the two areas that it sort of fell down for me were, one, it took a lot of time to develop the configurations for it, and so and the test cycle was basically reinstall the machine all the time, so while you're getting all your classes right, that took a lot of work. The other problem is that you have to reinstall the machine to get to do its stuff. Whereas, well, that may have changed, like I said, it probably 5 years out of date now. So if you can
run it. We are just using a soft update from FAI, so we have an installation with re-release, maybe release 1.0, and when we add new software, release 1.1, we just say, okay, FAI soft update, and then the whole FAI mechanism is running on the client.
Yeah.
And just updating the software, running the new scripts.
Well, that's cool because
so
certainly 5 years
like
ago,
we're using the graphical user interface for FAI.
Uh-huh.
Of course, we don't have Unix administrators or just a few in the city.
Yeah.
And so we are using Goza, the Go Ecosystem Administrator. It's an LDAP management tool. And during the last 1.5 years, we're developing FAI front end for Goza. So we run our whole installation and updating through web interface. So you manage your whole system, printers, users, groups, everything in LDAP, and just trigger, okay, this 10 machines have to get a new update or a new installation, and it's running.
I have a remark to you. You say that the test cycle to install a fire installation is to reinstall the machine.
Yeah,
well, that's my main complaint about DI, because if I want to test my precedes file and I want to check if it's correct to make a change to the DI precedes, I really have to rerun everything.
Yeah.
And so that's my main complaint of DI. With FYI, I have either a soft updates or I have this class script. There are shell or class script which I can run on a machine. So I think it's more easy to with FYI to many tests.
Yeah, I didn't know about soft updates. That's at least what you pretty cool.
But even with our soft updates, the classes that you can run on any machine without an installation. They are just normal shell scripts. Just see what they do on standard out.
It's also so that Fire gives you an entire full blown script around whether as a system around whether as the DIs is a physical based system, so you've got your more limited there.
Still not a system.
Well, Fire gives you a full blown system on a Linux router or CD or something, whereas DI gives you a busy box based system to run on, which is more limited.
Does Fire still require an FS?
I don't know what it is, but it's...
It's like, there's a medieval mode of operation. Yeah.
There is a facility called PhyCD, so you can copy the NFS root on USB stick or flight on CD, okay. And put the config space on that medium, so you can have fully unauthorized installation booting from a CD-ROM if TFTP and NFS routing is a complicated way.
Actually, when we are using Gordo, we have improved that mechanism, so you can just configure your system inside the other with the interface and just say create CD, and then you just send EDD, because there are some parts of the system of the city of Munich which just have 10 megabit connection, and installing over a 10 megabit connection, a whole PC with 1.5 gigabyte data is just
right.
Takes hours. So we just create the CDs and send them out and say, okay, put them in your DVD drive and wait 15 minutes, something like that, and then the PC is installed. So that's quite easy.
About the shell script you run in DI, I think there's a hook where you can... I think there's a hook in the DI preseed where you can run a shell script once the system is rebooted. So, does it involve some matter?
Right. How I've been using it is to... You can specify in the preseed script that it should run a shell script. And what we've been doing is the shell script is to be run is wget from some URL and pipe it into binsh. And, well, okay, you can do configuration like this, but then you have to re-implement your whole class management, in which class is this machine, and you have basically to re-implement half of file with that. So just use Fi in the first place. Why not using it in the first place?
Yeah, I have a request from one of the other meetings, I18N. They said one of the big problems they're having right now is def config. Loads all of the languages as one big block. What we'd like to do is be able to somebody have a screen and say, check all the languages you want. You know, so there's a language initially checked, and you can check more languages, and then it would only load that. They say that's a problem with dev config and something related to DI. And also, they're loading all of those languages twice. So they're asking for somebody to help a memory mapper so that it only gets loaded once.
I think I've heard some about this in the Debian I18N archives about the translation decks and so on.
So what the idea is both. So there were talks about the translation DB. On the wiki page, there's a wiki page search for translation deb, and there's a whole discussion about translation leakage.
Just sort of tie up. If anybody has bright ideas about that, I assume going along to the IAT internationalization. BOF or work groups that are sort of being held each day would be a good idea for that.
Yeah,
8 o'clock.
No.
Just 8 o'clock.
Yeah. In fact, we talked just about installing PC, but I tried that not a long time ago, but I tried Puppet, which is a kind of CF engine. I don't know if you know it, but in fact, when I try to install new PC. I'm not a system administrator, so I don't install a lot of PC, but just mine. In fact, I just go to bare system installer configuration. In fact, I install a very small set of package, and then I've built a artifact which under all the other debt which are required and the puppet in it. So I install all the package and then I run puppet which configure all the package in fact by just replacing configuration file and restarting service for each service which are required. So, and I get a solution where since Puppet is still running, if I don't know, if a few weeks later after installing the PC, I want to update a specific part of the system. Just I want to change the configuration file of NSS switch, for example. I just have to go to my central Puppet master and change the file here, and it will change on every PC. And I got a solution where the solution, in fact, is installation and further management of the PC. So I don't know if it's good for PC installation, because it's not as automated as it should be. But I don't know if that's, I just want to ask the people if they are used to this kind of solution, either with CF engine or with Puppet.
I've used CF engine in the past. I managed to automate most things with that, and maybe somebody else using CF engine on the end there. Anybody using Puppet yet? Which are you using?
Well, I'm using CF engine, the department, for various reasons, for mostly historic reasons. We use it to update and to install Debian packages on our machines and so forth. In the other department I know they basically hook CF engine into Phi, to use Phi to bootstrap a CF engine installation on the workstation and then get going to configure things like XORConf, network authentication and various other things you need to do.
And you use that to configure the backup to run as well, I mean, because I can't see any reason why not.
Well, not exactly, we could do that, but most of the machines are just workstations which can be installed automatically, and the actual data which needs to be backed up are on special file servers which have backup configured manually. But if we would use CF engine and Phi to install servers, it would of course make sense to automate this as well.
Seeing as it's only 5 or 10 minutes to lunch, shall we wrap up here? Thank you. It's sort of interesting for me after the no end. I hope it was useful for the rest of us. Thank you very much. Give yourself a round of applause.